Hello and welcome to today's video lecture of Object-Oriented Programming using Java with the paper code CS504A. Myself Shaini Chandra, Assistant Professor of Department of Computer Science and Engineering of Guru Nanak Institute of Technology. So let's look at today's lecture contents. Today we will be learning about type conversion and casting applied on Java language. So as you already have previous programming experience, because you already know about C and C++ languages, so you already know that it is fairly common to assign a value of one data type to a variable of another data type. Now, if the two types are compatible, then Java will perform the conversion automatically. For example, we can say that it is always possible to assign an integer value to a long variable, because the two data types, which are int and long, both are of integer types. That means both are compatible with each other. However, not all types are compatible, and thus not all type conversions are implicitly allowed. For instance, we can say that there is no automatic conversion defined from double to byte. Fortunately, it is still possible to obtain a conversion between the incompatible types, and to do so, we have to use a cast, which is known as casting. This type casting concept is already discussed in C and C++ languages. The type casting concept that you have already learned in C language is also applied in Java language. Now, this type casting performs as an explicit conversion between incompatible types. Now we have to learn both these types, that are automatic type conversions and casting. So let's first learn about automatic type conversion in Java. When one data type is assigned to another data type of variable, an automatic type conversion will take place if and only if these two rules that are specified here are met, or these two conditions are satisfied. Now, what are these two rules? The first rule is saying that the two types are compatible, and the second rule is saying that the destination type is larger than the source type. These are the two rules. Only if they are satisfied, then the automatic type conversion will take place in Java. Remember that both the rules have to be satisfied in order to Java do the automatic type conversion. Now, when these two conditions are met, a widening conversion will take place. Now, what is this widening conversion? For example, we can say that integer type is always large enough to hold all the byte variables values. So no explicit cast statement is required. Instead, the byte variables values will be automatically casted into the integer types. That means automatically the byte values will be converted into the integer values. So there the automatic type conversion will take place. For widening conversions, the numeric types, including integer and floating point types, are compatible with each other. However, there are no automatic conversions from the numeric types to char or boolean. Also, char and boolean are not compatible with each other. That means there will be no automatic type conversion between char and boolean. Now, as I have already told that Java also performs an automatic type conversion. Now, this automatic type conversion can be done also when storing a literal integer constant into variables of type byte, short, long, or char. This concept has already been discussed in my previous lecture while discussing integer literals. Now, let's see with an example how Java's automatic type conversion will take place. Let us suppose that there is a byte variable declared as byte B, and there is also another variable declared as int, like int I. Now, if you want to assign the value of the byte variable into the integer variable, this can be done by Java automatically. This is known as Java's automatic type conversion. Now, let's look how this automatic type conversion is taking place, whether the two rules for Java's automatic type conversions are met or not. The first rule says that the two types must be compatible. Now, the two data types are byte and int. Both the types are compatible because both are of integer types. That means the first condition, that is the two types or the two data types must be compatible. The first condition is already satisfied. The second condition says that the destination type is larger than the source type. Here we want to store the value of the byte variable into the integer variable. That means this is my destination type. This is my destination variable and this is my source variable. So source variable is the one whose value I want to store into another variable, and the destination variable is the one into which we want to store the variable, the value of the source variable. So I here is the destination variable and B here is the source variable. Now the second condition of Java's automatic conversion says that the destination type must be larger than the source type. That means the destination type is of int type and the source type is of byte type. So obviously the destination here is larger than the source, because we know that integer is larger than byte in case of data types. That means the two conditions for Java's automatic conversions are already met. That's why the byte value will be easily stored into the integer variable I. There need not to use any cast, or there need not to do type casting. So this is how Java's automatic type conversion takes place. Remember that the two conditions must be met. That is, the destination should be greater than the source and the two types must be compatible with each other. Now let's see how incompatible types are being casted. Although the Java's automatic type conversions are helpful, they will not fulfill all the needs. For example, you can say that, what if you want to assign an int value to a byte variable? That means, what if we want to do the exactly opposite thing that we are doing here? Here we are assigning a byte variable's value into an integer variable. But if we want to assign an integer variable's value into a byte variable, then we cannot do it without typecasting. This conversion will not be performed automatically because a byte is smaller than an int. That means this condition, the second condition of Java's automatic type conversion, which says that the destination type must be larger than the source type, is not met. Although the two types are compatible, although the first condition of Java's automatic type conversion is met, but the second condition is not met. That's why it will not do automatic type conversion. You have to do type casting. This kind of conversion is sometimes known as a narrowing conversion. Java's automatic type conversion was called widening conversion, as we have already told, but this one, which is known as type casting, that you have already learned in other languages previously, is known as a narrowing conversion. Since you are explicitly making the value narrower so that it will fit into the target type. Now, in order to create such a conversion between two incompatible types, you must use a cast. A cast is simply an explicit type conversion, nothing else. Now, the general form of using a cast is like this. So this will be the name of the variable and this will be the target data type into which we want to cast it to. So this is the general syntax of using a cast. So basically this target type specifies the desired data type into which we want to convert the specified value to. Now this is the specified value which we want to convert. For example, we can say that Suppose, so let's take this example again. So here we have declared a byte variable b and an integer variable I. Now suppose we want to store the value of the integer variable I into the byte variable b. In that case, the variable's name here is I. So I is the value actually whose value we want to store into the byte variable b. Now we have to use a cast. So this should be the target type. Target type means the value of the variable I should be stored in a byte variable. So the target data type is actually byte. The data type of this variable, this is our target variable. The data type of this variable is the target data type. So we have to write here byte. So this thing is of the form this. This is the target type, which is byte in our case, and the value is I. The variable's value, the I variable's value will be stored into the variable B, which is of byte type. So this is known as typecasting. Now a different type of conversion will occur when a floating point value is assigned to an integer type. In that case, truncation will happen. Now, as you all know that integers do not have any fractional components, thus we can say that when a floating point value is assigned to an integer type, the fractional component will be lost. For example, we can say if a value 1.23 is assigned to an integer, let's take it as an example. Suppose we have taken a float variable, say float f, and we have assigned a value 1.23 into the variable f. Now we have taken another integer variable, say a, int a. Now if we want to assign this 1.23 value into this integer variable a, the resulting value will simply be 1. That means if we want to do it like this, the value of the variable f is 1.23. But we know that integers can only hold whole numbers. It cannot hold fractional components. So the fractional component, that is the component that is there after the decimal point in this f variable, will be truncated, and only the whole part, that is 1, will be stored into the integer variable 1. That means the 0.23, this part is truncated. And only the whole part, that is 1, is left. So this part will be stored into A. So if you print the value of the variable A, it will give you 1. Now, of course, if the size of the whole number component is too large to fit into the target integer type, then that value will be reduced modulo the target of type's range. Now, let's see with an example, what does this actually mean? Here I have done a program. This program will give you a clear idea about how the type casting is taking place. Here you can see that we have taken a class conversion. You can give obviously any name to this class. We have just given the name conversion. Then inside the class, we have defined the main method. You already know how to define a main method. Now inside the main method, we have taken three variables. The first variable is byte variable. This b variable is a byte variable because its data type defined is byte. The second variable we have taken is I, which is an integer variable, and a value initialization has taken place. The value 257 is stored into the integer variable I. Next, a double variable has been taken. D is the double variable, and a value 323.142 has been assigned into it. Now next, we are just printing a simple statement. A slash n is there. This slash n is the escape sequence, which will give you a new line, nothing else. this ln will also give you a new line, but after this statement is printed, then this ln will give you the new line. So basically this statement, conversion of int to byte, will be printed in a new line because of this slash n. And after that, the cursor will go to a new line because of this ln. Okay, after that, this operation will take place. B equals to byte I. Now see, this byte, this I variable contains a value 257. Okay, and the range of the, let's see it here, the range of a byte variable is -128 to +127. We know that this is the range of a byte data type. Now this range actually means that 256. This range actually means 256, because from -128 to +127, if we calculate, the range will be 256. Now, the value that we want to store here, the value that we want to store here into the byte variable B is 257. 257 is beyond the range of the byte variable. That means this value 257 is way too large to be stored into the byte variable B. That means the value 257, even after casting, we have used the cast here, our target data type is byte. Even after this casting, this value of the I variable 257 cannot be stored into the byte variable B. The value of the integer variable I is 257. Even after using this cast, we cannot store this value 257 into the byte variable B, because this value 257 is way too large to be stored into the byte variable B. So if this is the case, then what will happen? This 257 value will be, this 257 value will be divided by 256, which is the range of the byte data type. And it will be a modulo division, and the remainder, which is actually 1, will be stored into the byte variable. So this type of conversion will take place when, even after casting, the value of the source variable is way too large to be stored in the destination variable. This type of division, modulo division, will take place only then. So in this case, the range of the byte variable is 256, -128 to +127 is 256. So the source variable's value, which is 257, will be modulo divided by 256, and the remainder, which is 1, will be stored into the byte variable B. So if you print the value of both the variables I and B, this I will give you 257, and this B will give you this B, which is actually 1. And I have already discussed about this way of displaying something on screen in the previous lecture. Today also I'm giving you a brief overview of it. Here in this statement, we just want to print these things. Now I and B, after that a space, this thing has been enclosed within double quotes. That means this whole thing will be displayed on screen as it is. After that, a plus is used, because after this space, the value of the I variable will be concatenated. And to do that concatenation, this plus operator is used. After this value of the I variable, this space will be concatenated, and this space will be concatenated after I using this plus operator. After this space, the value of the B variable will be concatenated using this plus operator. So these three plus operators are actually concatenating each other. So this statement will give you the value of the I variable as 257 and the value of the B variable as 1. Now let's move on to the next one. There is another println statement here. So this statement will be printed on screen as it is, which will give you conversion of double to int. So in the next two statements, we will do conversion from double to int. So this statement will be printed on screen with a new line before it, because we have given an escape sequence slash n here, and this ln will be executed after this full stop. So after this period, this ln will give you a new line, and the next statements will be printed in that new line. Now, the next operation that we are performing is again a casting, where we are just storing the value of d into the integer variable I. Now the d variable's value is 323.142. So we have already told that if you want to store a floating point value into an integer data type, then the fractional part, that means the part after the decimal point, will be omitted, as we know that integer data type can only hold whole numbers. It cannot hold any fractional numbers. So this d is a fractional number which contains a fractional part 0.142. This 0.142 part will be discarded, and the whole part, which is 323, is left. This 323 is completely within the range of the variable I, which is an integer variable. So this value 323 will be stored into the I variable. In the next statement, we are printing the values of D and I. So when you will print the value of D, it will give you 323.142. And when you are printing the value of the variable I, it will just give you 323. That means the fractional part has been truncated, as it is an integer variable. So let's move on to the next three statements. In the next statement, we have again printed a simple text, which is conversion of double to byte. Before this statement, a new line will be there because a slash n is inserted. And after this statement, this ln will give you a new line again. After that, we are again doing a casting operation, which says b equals to byte d. That means the value of the variable d will be casted into the byte variable. Now here again, b is an integer type variable. We know that byte is an integer type data type. That means b is an integer type data type, byte data type, which is an integer type data type. That means in case of this casting also, the fractional part will be truncated. That means only the whole part will be remained. That means 323 should be stored into byte variable b. But this 323 is beyond the range of the byte variable b. Byte data type has a range -128 to +127, which is 256 actually. But 323 is way too large to be stored into the byte variable b. That means 323 is beyond the range of the byte data type. So here also the modulo division will take place, and in this case, the modulo division will take place like 323 will be modulo divided by 256, and the remainder part will be stored into the byte data type. So the remainder part will be stored into the byte data type. Whatever it is, it will be stored into the byte variable. So this b value will contain the remainder of the modulo division of 323 by 256. Now, if we print the value of these two variables, d will give you 323.142, and the value of the b variable will be the modulo division result of 323 by 256. Now, let's go to command prompt to execute this program and see the output. So you can see that the name of the program is conversion.java because the main method is within the class conversion. So our main class name is conversion. So we have saved the file conversion.java in desktop. So we are already in desktop. So please let us compile it. Java C space conversion.java. So it is perfectly okay. No errors are there. That means it is successfully compiled. Now we will execute it. Okay, so we can see that the first output is conversion from int to byte. The int variable's value is 257, which is displayed, but B holds 1, which is the modulo division result of 257 by 256. The next one is conversion from double to int. The variable's value, D variable's value is 323.142, which is displayed, and I variable after casting contains the whole part of this value only, that is 323. The last one is the conversion from double to byte. The value of the D variable is 323.142, and the value of the B variable is 67, which is the remainder of the modulo division of 323 by 256. So this is how normally typecasting takes place in Java, and we have already discussed about Java's automatic type conversion also. So now let's move on to the next topic of type conversion and casting, which is automatic type promotion in expressions. Now, in addition to assignments, there is another place where certain type conversions may occur in expressions. Now, let's consider an example, say, like this. Now see this problem. The result of the intermediate term, which is A into B. The result of this intermediate term A into B is 40 into 50, which will give you 2000. Now this 2000 value easily exceeds the range of either of its byte operands. That means the value intermediate result, which is 2000, will exceed the range of this A variable or the range of this B variable, because both are byte variables. Now the range of the byte variable is, I have already told in the last example, which is 128 to plus 127. So this 2000 is beyond this range. Right. Now to handle this kind of problem, Java has proposed a solution, which is Java will automatically promote each byte short or char operand to int when evaluating an expression. This means that the sub expression A into B, this one, this sub expression A into B is performed using integers, not bytes. That's why 2000, which is the result of this intermediate expression, is legal even though A and B are both specified as byte types. Now, as useful as the automatic promotions are, but they can also create some confusing compile time errors. For example, let's see this code fragment. Byte B equal to 50. And an operation which is B equal to B into 2. Here you can see that the variable's value, B variable's value is 50, which is perfectly within this range. Now B into 2 will give you 50 into 2. That is 100. Now this 100 is also within this range. Now so this value 100 can easily be stored into this B variable. So B variable can easily contain 100. Now, if you want to print this value of the variable B, it will give you error. So that's because of the reason that Java automatically promotes each of the byte, short or char operands into int that I have just told. That means when evaluating this expression b into 2, that is 50 into 200, Java has automatically promoted this expression, this result of this intermediate expression into integer. That means this 100 is now an integer value that we want to store into a byte variable, which is not possible without casting. That means in order to work this code fragment perfectly, we have to use this statement like this. Otherwise, if we write it like this, this will give you error. But this may sometimes create confusing compile time errors. It may happen that the programmers may think that why it is giving errors, because b into 2, which is calculated as 100, is perfectly within this range of byte, and we want to store this byte value into the byte variable 100. So what can be the problem? The problem is that Java automatically promotes each byte, short or char operands to int when evaluating expressions. So that's why this 50 into 2 b into 2, which is 50 into 200, is automatically converted into integer, and we want to store this integer value 100 into a byte variable, which is not possible without casting. So if you want to make this program run, you have to use this cast explicitly, or you have to do type casting. Similarly, in this case, you may think that 40 into 50, which is 2000, this value is outside the range of both the variables A and B. We are actually evaluating A into B, and the intermediate result will give you 2000, which is beyond the range of the byte variables A and B. Then also it is not giving any error. Why? Because it is automatically converted into integer while evaluating expression. Java does this. So 2000 is perfectly an integer value. That's why no problem is there while evaluating this expression, and the expression will run perfectly. So this is how Java's automatic type promotion in case of expressions take place. Now let's see what are the type promotion rules that are being applied. Some type promotion rules are there that are being applied while evaluating Java's automatic type promotion, while doing Java's automatic type promotion in expressions. The rules are as follows. First, all byte, short and char values are promoted to int. If there are byte or short or char values, they will be automatically promoted to int. I have just described that. Now, then it will see if one operand is a long, then the whole expression will be promoted into long. Then it will see if any float operands are there or not. If any float operands are there, if at least one float operand is there, then the entire expression will be promoted to float. Then it will see if any double operands are there or not. If any of the double operands are there, if any of the operands is double, then the result will be converted into double. Now let's see this with an example. Here you can see that we have used a class named promote. You can obviously use any other name of the class. This is the main method. Inside this main method, we have declared 6 variables of 6 different data types. The first one is a byte variable b, which has been assigned a value 42. The next one is a char variable c, which has been assigned a single character a. That's why it is enclosed within single quotes. The next one is a short variable s, which has been assigned a value 1024. The next one is an integer variable I, which has been assigned a value 50,000. The next one is a float variable f, which has been assigned a value 5.67. Now this F is explicitly used to indicate that this 5.67 is a float literal or floating point literal. You can also use capital F here. Both will execute perfectly. The last variable is D, which is of double type, which has been assigned with a value 0.1234. Now we are writing an expression here. Here there are three parts in the expression. So now let's see how this expression will be evaluated and what will be the value that will be stored into the result variable. Now the first sub expression is F into B. Here we can see that B is a byte variable and this F is a float variable. So B will be promoted to float here, and the result of this sub expression F into B will be a float. The next sub expression is I by C. Now C is a char type and I is an integer type. That means C will be converted into int, and the result of this whole sub expression will be promoted to type int. The next one is D into S. Now we can see that D is a double variable, whereas S is a short variable. That means the value of S will be promoted to double, and the whole result of this sub expression will be promoted to double. Finally, these three intermediate values that are, this one is float, this one is integer, and this one is double, will be considered. Now the outcome of float plus int will be float. Then float, the whole thing, the first two sub expressions will result you in a float value. So float minus double, the last one is double, this expression will give you a double value. So float minus double will give you a double. That means the data type of the final result of this whole expression will be double. So this first sub expression will give you a float value. The second sub expression will give you an intermediate value, which is of the type int. The third sub expression will give you an intermediate value, which is of type double. So the first expression and first sub expression and second sub expression, float plus int, will give you float. So the first two sub expressions are done. So the first two are giving you float. So float minus the last sub expression, which gives you double. So float minus double will obviously give you double. That means this result variable will always contain a double value. That's why the data type has been taken as double. Now this system.out.println statement will just print the value of F into B plus is enclosed within double quotes. That means this plus will be printed on screen. Then this I by C, this will print you the value of the operation I by C. After that, this minus is enclosed within double quotes. So this minus will be printed on screen. And lastly, D into S, its value will be printed on screen. So firstly, the value of F into B will be printed on screen. After that, using this plus operator, this plus, which is a string, will be concatenated. After that, there is again another plus operator. That means the value of I by C, which is this one, the computed value of I by C, will be concatenated after this plus using this operator plus. So basically this plus is a string which we want to print on screen, and this plus is the concatenation operator. After that, there is again a plus operator which will do the concatenation of this string, which is minus, with this value. So this minus is a string that we want to display on screen, and this plus will do the concatenation between the value of I by C and minus. After that, there is again a plus operator which will concatenate this string minus with the value of D into S. And lastly, the value of the variable result will be printed on screen. Now let's execute this program to see the output. So I have already saved the program in desktop. So let's compile it. So it is successfully compiled. That means no errors are there. So now let's execute it. So here you can see that the first one that is being calculated is F into B. F means 5.67 into B, 42, which is giving you 238.14. The next one is I by C. I means 50,000 and C means A. Now, whenever we are calculating I by C, C is automatically promoted to int. Promoted to int means its Unicode value, the Unicode value of this small letter A will be taken into account, and that value will divide 50,000. So actually 50,000 will be divided by the Unicode value of A, which is 97. So 50,000 will be divided by 97, and that will give you 515. Now, that will not give you exactly 515, that will give you a fractional number, but as it is promoted to int and int can only hold whole numbers, so the fractional part will be omitted. The last one, which is D into S, that is 0.1234, will be multiplied with 1024, and the result will be promoted to double, which will give you 126.3616. So this part is in float, this part is in int, and this part is in double. So 238.14 plus 515 will give you a float value, and that, and my subtract 126.3616 from that value will give you a double value, which is the ultimate value that is stored in the double variable result. So this is the ultimate value that you can see on screen. So this is all about type conversion and casting that are being applied on Java. Today you have learned how Java does automatic type conversion and how type casting takes place in the same way as you have learned in C or C++ languages. And today you have also learned about how Java does automatic type promotion while evaluating expressions. So in the next lecture, we will discuss about arrays in Java. You will see that the concept is more or less same that you have already learned in other languages, but the implementations are totally different. Obviously, some variations are there in concepts also that we will discuss in the next lecture. Thank you for listening to today's lecture.